today we're going to deal with communion, and then the next time we meet, we're going to deal with anointing and anointing oil. We have a fourth Sunday coming up. There's five Sundays in January. How do y'all feel about meeting up again next week?
Third.
This is the third. So we wouldn't be meeting for another 2 weeks until February. And I kind of want to get with this anointing thing and go ahead and teach on that. So if you don't mind, go ahead and have a fourth Sunday service.
Okay.
Sounds good to me too.
Amen.
So this is going to deal with communion. And we're going to take a look at communion. Most of us are familiar with it on a very high level, with the fact that they're little cups with some kind of juice or water or wine in them, and you eat the little crackers, the little wafers. And everybody stands up and you recite the verse, and you eat it, and you drink it, and they tell you it means something, and you know it means something because they tell you it means something. But why we actually do it, where it came from, what the meanings are behind it, and some of the differences in doctrine and opinion, we haven't dealt with. As a matter of fact, Brother Bill, you asked me one time while we were still at the house, it might have been about a year ago, about the Eucharist. He mentioned to me, what is that and what are they talking about? And I don't know if you remember asking the question or not, but I tend to remember things that there's no good reason to remember. But you asked me about it, and we're going to touch on that today.
Okay.
We're going to deal with a passage of scripture that I think is probably the most comprehensive scripture. You find the Lord's Supper or communion mentioned in several different passages, in Matthew 26 and Mark 14 and in Luke 22. I have that footnoted on the bottom of your scripture page. But the one that we're going to work from today is taken from 1 Corinthians. Yes, please. It's taken from 1 Corinthians. This is Paul writing to Christians in the city of Corinth about a problem that they have with the Lord's Supper. And it reads, starting in this 12th chapter and the 17th verse, "But in the following instructions, I cannot praise you, for it sounds as if more harm than good is being done when you meet together." Not a preach right there by itself. "First, I hear that there are divisions among you when you meet at church, and to some extent I believe you, but of course, there has to be a divisions among you so those who have God's approval will be recognized. When you meet together, you're not really interested in the Lord's Supper, for some of you hurry to eat your own meal without sharing with others. As a result, some go hungry while others get drunk." Thank you. Let me back that up and read that again. "When you meet together, you're not really interested in the Lord's Supper, and for some of you, you hurry and eat your own meal without sharing with others. As a result, some go hungry while others get drunk." Let me back that up again. This is him writing to the Christian church, the Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized, running on in the name of the Lord, folks who are getting together and meeting at church. "When you meet together, you're not really interested in the Lord's Supper. For some of you, hurry to eat your own meals without sharing with others. As a result, some go hungry while others get drunk. What, don't you have your own homes for eating and drinking? Or do you really want to disgrace God's church with shame and shame the poor? What am I supposed to say? Do you want me to praise you? Well, certainly I will not praise you for this. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night he was betrayed, the Lord took some bread and gave thanks to it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'"
Amen.
"In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it.'"
Amen.
"For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. So, anyone who eats this bread and drinks of the cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself."
Amen.
"That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died.
Amen.
But if we would examine ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this way. Amen. Yet when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that way we will not be condemned along with the world." That'll preach too. "So, my dear brothers and sisters, when you gather for the Lord's Supper, wait each of you for the other. If you are really hungry, eat at home, so you won't bring judgment upon yourselves when you meet together. I give you instructions about the other matters when I arrive." I really like the New Living Translation of this passage because it makes it kind of plain as to what's going on, and you get to see that some of the pettiness that goes on in church now isn't necessarily new stuff, that people have always been people and people have always had issues. But we have instructions dealing with communion. And I guess I should start out by asking how everyone out, or for comments on how people have understood or what people have understood communion to be and why we take communion up to this point. I want to see what your understanding of it is. Anybody ever taken communion? Anybody ever known why they partook of communion?
Basically, it's the body and blood of Jesus Christ.
Okay.
That's what they told us as kids.
As many people have died throughout the years.
Okay. Body and blood of Jesus Christ. Why are we eating the body and blood of Jesus Christ?
In remembrance of Jesus.
In remembrance of Jesus Christ. And his death? Okay, good answer. Good. And none of that is wrong. I just wanted to, you know, if you want, I don't want to sit here and talk at y'all forever, and I also want to know where everybody is. Communion, if you had to sum it up, and this is Mike's definition, or Mike's, you know, I could come up with something fancy, but I don't feel like it. Communion is a ritual instituted by Jesus to commemorate his life, his death, and the new covenant established by his sacrifice. Now, some of these other names that we have come to hear it by. When you hear the term Eucharist, it's talking about communion. When you hear the term Holy Communion, it's talking about communion. The Lord's Supper, all terms for the same thing. And it's regarded differently depending on what denominational background you came from. Does anybody in here know what a sacrament is? Ever heard the term before? Sacraments?
Yeah.
We don't do sacraments as a Protestant people. We don't really have very many. We got the Holy Ghost. Okay. And I'll explain that in a second. A sacrament is, within the Catholic religion, within some of the Methodist faiths, Eastern Orthodoxy, they are rituals that you engage in where a person, where the grace of God is conferred upon a person. So we receive grace through the relationship of God. We experience the presence of God by his Spirit communing with us. Some branches of Christianity aren't that big on the whole Spirit thing. It makes them uncomfortable. It's an issue, and we can talk about why that is another time. But everybody isn't keen on the active Spirit of God among people. And for a lot of them, the way that they receive God's grace is through participating in a ritual. So the thing that affords us forgiveness, the thing that affords us the presence of God or allows us to go into God's presence is his grace that we understand he bestows upon us freely. For them, they receive it by going through a ritual. The Roman Catholic Church, for example, baptism, for us, we tend to look at it as a symbolic gesture of an inward confession. For them, they look at it as a ritual where something supernatural is being bestowed upon them when you are baptized. Confirmation, the Eucharist or communion, penance, when you go to make confession and then you pay penance or you do penance. That's a way of receiving God's grace by those actions. Anointing of the sick, holy orders or ordinations, and marriage are all means. They're rituals. For us, you go up, you say the words, and then you're married, and you sign the paper, and then you're married. They believe that God confers grace upon the marriage, which is why adult relationships are no longer inappropriate within the confines of a marriage, because God's grace has been conferred upon that union, and that's the way that they see it. So it's a little bit of a different mechanism. We believe in the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. They believe in experiencing God's grace through ritual. That's what a sacrament is. So you got some people that see the Eucharist as a sacrament, other people see it as an ordinance. And the difference between a sacrament and an ordinance is that an ordinance is something instituted as a ritual of remembrance. And we're going to talk about remembrance a little bit more deeply in a little while. But if my means of receiving God's grace is through this ritual, it takes on a much different meaning to me than it's just something that I do because they were told me to, because I was told that I should do it. Now my immortal soul and my relationship with God is attached to going through this ritual. That's why you get so much. Some of what we're going to talk about is really, really can be really convoluted, and we're just going to touch on it on the surface level. But folks get real deep with this, and the reason folks get super deep with this is because there's something a lot more meaningful attached to people who see it as a sacrament than people who experience it as an ordinance. Most of your Protestant churches and your Protestant denominations deal with communion as an ordinance. It's a ritual that we go through for the sake of remembrance. And I'm not here to say which one is right or which one is wrong. That's way above my pay grade, and that's above any bishop's pay grade. That's between God and his people. It's a different way of doing things, and I'm not here judging, condemning, just informing. So that way you can form your own opinions on what you believe is right or wrong about it. So we've got ordinance. When a sacrament is seen as something in and of itself sacred, or whereas a sacrament is seen as of something in and of itself as sacred, an ordinance is a practice that merely demonstrates the participant's faith because they believe these rituals are outward expressions of faith rather than impartations of God's grace. Let's go back to baptism as an example that just came to mind. Some of us know that if you get baptized and there is no faith behind it and there's no confession, then you go down wet or dry and you come up wet. For those who believe in that when God's grace is conferred upon you, and this is why they have no problem with infant baptism, it doesn't really matter what the inward reality is. If a priest dunks you, and they don't dunk, but if a priest were to dunk you and because you said you wanted to be baptized, God's grace is automatically conferred. The act itself is what makes the change, and not necessarily the inward transformation.
So is that the once saved, always saved, like?
Not quite,
okay.
It could work that way if you were always a good Catholic.
Okay.
But within Catholicism, for and I keep picking on that because they're the big ones with the sacrament that everybody's familiar with. If you do something that causes you to fall out of grace with God, then the grace of God can be conferred by you paying penance. That's the way you're going through it, or doing penance. That's the way you're going through and receiving God's grace again. So you can always come back, but they believe, unless they excommunicate you, which we don't do, but there's, you know, it gets kind of dicey. They've got some doctrines that we're not familiar with, but no, it's not once saved, always saved, but if somebody was always a good Catholic for the rest of their life, then yeah, I baptize you as an infant, and you're good to go, as long as you don't mess nothing up. Doesn't matter whether or not you knew what you were doing, whether or not you, no, I was baptized as an infant, I was a recipient of God's grace, I went through confirmation at the age of 13, because that's what they told me to do, and said, okay, I sign up for this, and then for as long as you go about life, you're good, until you mess something up, and then they make you go do something to fix it. So that's the difference between a sacrament and an ordinance. We're familiar. What kind of bread do they use for communion?
Depends on the bread.
Little crackers?
Yeah.
What makes those little crackers? Crackers?
I don't know.
Are they rich crackers?
Yeah.
Unleavened. Unleavened.
They don't have yeast.
Yeah.
Right. Unleavened bread.
Yeah.
So, this is going to be a much more discussion type than the last one where I sat and talked, but so they'll use unleavened bread in that feast or in the Lord's Supper. Why do they use unleavened bread?
I don't know. I guess to go without the yeast. I think it's to go without it.
Why don't they want yeast in their bread?
Does that have something to do with Jesus not going without food for so long?
No, it's a good guess.
Is it the same bread David ate?
The showbread?
Showbread.
I don't know. I don't think so. It might have been.
Okay. When you say it was a holy bread, like the priest only eat, I can't remember what it was, but it was something about the priest ate bread, but it was something that Jesus ate one time. He was hungry and he said, why do you eat this bread? But I forget. I shouldn't have made it.
No, you're fine. I'm trying to get you guys kicking around.
Up here.
Now, if you were here on New Year's Eve, we touched on this.
Right.
It was the...
Exodus, and I even mentioned, and I don't know how many, if anybody went back and looked at any of this, but I said one of the things, you can look at Exodus 12 and 13, because we're going to be touching on some of that again this week. Am I driving anybody's memories?
Don't ask me to pull it up.
All right. Unleavened bread. Unleavened bread.
They had to leave and...
Okay. Thinking about that bread that the Israelites took from Egypt.
Close, close. When they were getting ready to leave, right before the plague of the death angel, okay, this, God tells Moses to institute a feast. Mm-hmm. And as part of that feast, as a matter of fact, let me grab, this is why I keep this over here. I didn't put it in the notes because I didn't, we're going to touch on it a little bit. But, Exodus 12, this is when God is getting ready to send the death angel. Let's see, there's the death angel, and they will, you know, Sodom and this, pass the Egypt. Okay, and this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. By an ordinance. 7 days you will eat unleavened bread. Even the first day you will put away leaven out of your houses, for whosoever eateth the leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And in the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and in the seventh day there will be a holy convocation to you. No manner of work will be done in them, save that which man must eat, that only may be done of you. And you will observe the feast of unleavened bread. In the selfsame day have I brought you your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever. So it just so happened that was instituting the feast of unleavened bread, which happened in the spring, and I don't know if you guys remember, but we talked about the fact that God told Moses, this is going to be the first month for you. You're halfway in, you know, you're third of the way to the year, but this is your first month. And on the seventh day of the first month, you are going to start a feast. And that feast is going to be the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And you're putting all the leaven away, and then, or was it the 14th day? Seventh day or 14th day? I should know that, but I don't. Off the top of my head. 14th to 21st. It is the 14th. So from the 14th day of the month to the 21st day of the month, you're not going to eat any bread with leaven. If there's any leaven or yeast in the house, you messed up. Get all the leaven out.
Right.
Take it off your property. Nobody's eating anything with any leaven in it, so y'all are going to be eating dry crackers. And they did it. God institutes this as an ordinance to remind them of his taking them out of Egypt with a strong hand. Mm-hmm. Well, fast forward a few thousand years, it just so happens that the Lord's Supper is taking place at the same time as the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And that is why when Jesus took bread, he had unleavened bread. Because they were engaging in a time period of preparation and feast to remind them of God's deliverance from Israel. We'll come back to that in a second. But that's where we could take that from. And you can find that in Mark, the 12th chapter. It says that this likely took place 2 or 3 days before the Passover feast, which took place at the end of those, on the 21st day. This was a huge deal in Israel. Like, there was nothing bigger in their culture than making sure that they observed Passover by the time you get here. Every year, they got to make sure, we're not going to get into that. I don't have time for that. Yeah, let's keep moving. So that is why we have unleavened bread. We have unleavened bread because Jesus, that's the feast that was going on, so that's what Jesus had with him, and we've continued that throughout all of Christendom. That's what he ate, that's what we eat. What was in the cup?
Wine.
Wine.
Who says water?
Wine was in the cup.
Who says grape juice?
Pretty sure it was wine.
Who says wine?
What wine?
What you say? What about Tang?
Oh, it is one.
Okay. Who said water? And why did you say water?
I don't think anyone said
water. Did anybody say water? Okay. Where did we get the idea? Has anybody ever, besides me, ever taken water for communion?
No.
Seriously?
Seriously.
Ours is the only church.
No. Did little kids have to drink water?
No.
It was
always grape juice.
Oh, it was that Welch's stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is probably not nearly as relevant to you as it was to me, as it is to me. This conference, because growing up, we knew everybody else drank, like a bunch of people drank grape juice, but our church was one that drank water. And where that tradition came from was the idea somebody came up with, understood grape juice to be strong drink, because the Bible in the Old Testament continually talks about not drinking strong drink, and so they thought grape juice was strong drink, and so we're going to drink water. Plus, when Jesus was stabbed in the side, blood and water came out, so we're symbolizing his blood, and so water is an appropriate thing to substitute for, or to put into the cup.
What, blood and water?
So nobody's ever heard that before. Mm-hmm. Drinking water, drinking? Wow, I'm gonna have to get on the phone afterwards, and we're gonna laugh about that.
No.
Grape juice is a possibility because it says that it was fruit of the grape.
Mm-hmm.
He says, "But I said unto you, I will not drink henceforth the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom." Now, fruit of the vine could mean grape juice, reasonably. We could make that assertion. I don't think that's what it means. I suspect, and if I put 5 minutes in, I'm pretty sure that I could prove, that fruit of the vine in that day was considered wine.
Amen.
Wine was a staple of their diet. Now, some people say, Jesus drank wine? Yeah. I don't know if that's a strange concept to anybody, but for some people it is. And the way we can back that up comes from the book of Luke. People were criticizing Jesus for being extravagant and having too big of a following. And Jesus basically blasted them for having double standards or just looking for something to complain. He said, "For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and you said he had a devil. The Son of Man comes eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners." So that's where we can definitively say, and it was a part of their diet and their feast. This prohibition, or even temperance, didn't come until a long time after in America. That's why you have prohibitionist Christian doctrine, which I have no problem with. I grew up under it, and I'm perfectly fine with that, because we have a lot more stuff to drink now than that. At that time, they could drink the water, which who knows what was in it. They could drink wine or milk. I mean, they were a lot more limited. But my guess is that in the cup, there was probably wine, but grape juice works perfectly fine. People get bent out of shape over this stuff because, like I said, when you see it as a part of how you receive grace, you figure it's got to be the exact same thing. If we mess something up, it's not going to work. That's not necessarily the point of it. Wasn't for you to recreate the feast in its exactness. It was supposed to commemorate the death of Christ and commemorate his bread, death, and his body and his blood. So that's where we are for now. I wanted you to make sure you understood why people eat what they eat for communion, what's in the cup, why they drink it. So let's deal with this whole, this is my body which is given for you, my blood of the New Testament. What is the New Testament that he's referring to? When he says, this is my body which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me, this cup is the New Testament between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. What's the New Testament?
New law?
Probably a treaty or something.
Good answer, good answer. New Testament. You know we got Old and New Testament in the Bible, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Why do we call it the New Testament?
Because it's a new way to view it.
What'd you say?
A new agreement between God and man.
New agreement between God and man.
Because Old Testament, if you read the Old Testament, if you only read the New Testament, this is how I went, because I only read the New Testament when I was like, and I went back to the Old Testament, and I'm like, oh, whoa, hold on, they was cutthroat back then.
Yeah. They couldn't do nothing.
The New Testament, we under grace instead of the law. The old school was the law, and then this is new school, which is grace.
So where did we get the Old Testament from, or what is the Old Testament? Where in the Bible do we get that from?
Moses.
Yep. Moses, Mount Sinai, God gives the law. God says, you're going to be my people. God, well, let me back it up. God asks, will you be my, if you're my people, I'll be your God. And I'll bless those who bless you, and I'll curse them to curse you. This is immediately after he delivers them from Egypt. And the people say, yeah, this will work for us. So then God gives the law. He proposes marriage, then he establishes a covenant. And the covenant is the context in which the people were supposed to have a relationship with God, which contained the law and the commandments, and which moral law, legal law, case law. That's all the stuff that comes in Exodus and the Ten Commandments. That's the old covenant. And it contained lots of sacrifices that sealed the covenant, or stated that ratified or made the treaty effective. When he says that this is the New Testament purchased for you with my blood, he's saying we are creating a new covenant. And the price of this covenant is my blood. It is sealed by my blood. It's my new. You guys ever heard the phrase last will and testament?
Mm-hmm.
Same concept. Goes into effect as my blood is shed. I don't know if this is going to sound like a silly question or not to you, because it's one that was debated upon extensively over the centuries. Was Christ advocating for cannibalism when he says, this is my blood and this is my body?
No.
No? Not cannibalistic. So how was the bread his blood, or his body, and the wine his blood?
Representation.
You sure?
Simple. You broke the bread. Uh-huh. He broke the bread. The bread was his body. When he got on the cross, when he's doing that whole thing, he got broke.
Actually, he didn't get broke, but he did bleed. No broken bones, but his flesh was broken.
Yeah.
So, okay, gotcha. There has been throughout the ages, and I can't say wars because there was no actual official declaration of war, but people have died arguing over this throughout the history of Christianity. People at one point did not read the Bible as allegory, did not believe that anything was symbolic. On the other hand, they also knew that Jewish culture was not in favor of cannibalism, and so there's no way that God would have allowed people to eat blood or drink blood or eat flesh that was uncooked. They saw that much from Judaism. So how do we reconcile this? I'm going to throw some very multi-syllabic words at you that are very inane, and it's just so that way you guys were aware that the debates existed. There has been, over the years, questions of how does the blood body, or how does the bread become his body? And how does the wine become his blood? Because people have read it literally and tried to figure this out. One of the terms is transubstantiation. What happens when we actually eat the elements and drink the elements? Transubstantiation is a principle theory that says the substance, fundamental reality of the bread and wine is changed in a way beyond human comprehension into that of body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ. But the accidents or the physical traits, including the chemical properties of bread and wine, remain. This is the view held by the Roman Catholic Church, and it's taught by some Anglicans in Anglo-Catholic circles. So for the really deep people, they couldn't just say this is a symbol. No, it says, he doesn't say it's a symbol of my blood, of my body. It says this is my body. So how does this work? There are some people that believe, and I'm not talking like some crazy people over in a hole in the wall. There's an entire branch of Madrid that believes that when I eat the bread, it is mystically, I won't say magically because that would be demeaning in this context, it is mystically transformed into the body of Christ. So you didn't eat his flesh, you're not a cannibal, but somehow or another it transmogrifies. Yes, I said that.
Wow.
He thought it was funny.
Yeah.
Into the body. And when I drink the wine, it is transformed into the blood. And it is the blood and the body of Christ that has grace. And so when I eat that, it becomes a part of me. And that is how grace is conferred to taking communion. Transubstantiation. That's how they figure that that's how they think, that's how they believe that it works. I can't tell them that they're wrong, because I really don't know what happens aside from the fact that a bolus becomes interacted with salicylic acid and gets converted from a starch to a carbohydrate. But they weren't thinking about organic chemistry when they said it. there's another theory called consubstantiation that says the bread retains its substance and Christ's glorified body comes down into the bread through consecration and is found there together with the natural substance of the bread without quantity, but whole and complete in every part of the sacramental bread. So this theory says when the priest or the preacher prays over the elements, the grace of God, not his literal body, but the grace of God, his divine presence, is conferred upon the bread and the water. And the irony of this just hit me, because these are the same people that don't believe that God's spirit will live in a person, but that the power of God will live on the bread and the wine, and when you eat it, you internalize it, and that's how you receive God's grace. And that's their theology. Now, I want to contrast this for a second. And we've talked about the fact that sometimes we have a problem with trying to figure things out, right? That it is a tendency of our culture and our mentality to try to figure these things out that don't really need to be figured out. I want you to look at the way that they dealt with Jesus' disciples and the way that we end up dealing with it a couple hundred years later when you're dealing with people with Greek philosophies and mentalities. In Jesus' day, he said, "This is my body and this is my blood. Eat it, drink it," and they ate it and drank it. Fast forward a hundred years, "This is my blood, this is my body, eat it and drink it." They had to figure out how it worked. It's a little bit of a different approach. On the one hand, he says it, that's it. I don't need to figure it out. I can just eat, drink, and be merry and go along my way, understanding that I'm commemorating the death of Christ. On the other hand, you have, and there are, this is a pet peeve of mine, I'm not going off and deepen on it. There are so many branches of theology that exist because people ask too many questions about stuff that really don't matter. I mean, I could show you very large books that I have muddled through, and like, what difference does any of this make? And I'm not just, you know, some cynic or somebody that, I'm not a novice to scripture. I've got some insight and some experience. I'm sitting there reading this, like, nobody in their right mind would have asked this back in Jesus' day. And there's all this theology. There's a lot in theology to wade through and walk through. But, you know, we can't just eat, drink, and be. We have to figure out how this works. And so either the bread's transmogrified or the bread carries the anointing that I can't carry my own body, but I can eat it and digest it, and then I've got God's grace. I just want you to be aware of these things as we talk about these things. The last one is memorialism, which is much more aligned with what everybody else is saying, because we deal with this as an ordinance instead of a sacrament. The sacramental people need to have an answer. We can't just take for granted that Jesus said do it, so we do it. They got to figure it out. People that look at it from an ordinance point of view, the bread and the wine are symbolic of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And in partaking of the elements, the believer commemorates the sacrificial death of Christ. Christ is not present in the sacraments except in the hearts and the minds of the communicants. That's what everybody pretty much said in here. But if you didn't have somebody, you know, if you didn't have a teacher that was a little bit impaired, you'd never know that these other things existed. And I thought it would be interesting to share it with you. So this do in remembrance of me. And this is the last point that we really, I think, are going to have time to touch on. There is a difference. There's a subtlety in the language and the terminology that's used that deals with remembrance. If I say, "Do you remember what you had for breakfast this morning?" you just go back to recall a fact of what you had for breakfast this morning. Or, "Do you remember what you had for dinner yesterday?" I'm not going to go as far back as breakfast because I don't even know if I can ask that question. But we go back and we recall these events. That's not what this do in remembrance of me is talking about. There are two Greek terms. You know I'm terrible at Greek. But one is monomai and one is anamnesis in Greek. The term anamnesis is the one that's used here, and it's only used three times, maybe four times, in the New Testament. And it's always talking about a remembrance evoked by a feast where sacrifice is concerned. It's the difference between recalling something, which is what you did when I asked about breakfast, and remembering something wherein you relive the event to vivid detail. Most of us are most familiar with this when dealing with traumatic events, because not too many of us have things that go so positively that it's just always stuck in our mind forever. And we go back and we think about it and we get the same warm fuzzy. Our natural disposition is those things that are most traumatic to us, we think back, and we don't just remember or recall. We start to smell, we hear, we see, the room changes, people that are in the room go away. You may have been talking to somebody, but all of a sudden you don't realize that you were talking to them anymore, or words start to become difficult because your brain is going through a process of remembering that reanimates the past. You are no longer mentally in the present moment. You are recreating and reliving, remembering, experiencing something that was meaningful to you. Now, for somebody, they can remember when they were proposed to and how wonderful it was, and they start getting giggly and gushy and bubbly when they talk about it. Or somebody remembers the birth of their child and they're back in the hospital room with the beeps and the tweaks, and even though the wife was screaming and calling you all kinds of names and saying, "You did this to me," I remember, and there was the beeping and there was the smell and there was the McCoy, and then all, but there's a baby. And they remember with vividness. It's not just recall. Oh yeah, he was born on June 15th, 20. No, I remember, I relive in my remembrance that event to a degree that's way beyond just remember. And so for a lot of us, this doing remembrance of me just means, okay, I need to remember that Jesus died for me. I need to remember that he was beaten. I need to remember, you know, I need to recall as a factual event that this happened. And we think that this doing remembrance of me means that, okay, it means I'm supposed to take some time to think about the fact that Jesus died for me. It means he loves me. It means he was beaten for me. And somebody will give you a nice sermon about what that means to make you feel good. There's something that's supposed to happen that is almost transcendent in experiencing this and taking this in and ingesting this. Give you, there are some people, a lot of people, who 20 years from now will tell their kids about the inauguration of President Obama with fondness. They will talk about his presidency and the things that he overcame, and how his family was disrespected, and how he was disrespected, and how Congress wouldn't work with him, but he did this and he did that. Now, somebody else might have a completely different story to tell of the Obama presidency, but some of us are going to tell that story to our grandchildren, to our great-grandchildren, and we will remember, especially those who were products of the 60s and 70s, think back with awe about the magnitude of that moment. That's kind of what they were trying to point out to you if you ever saw the movie The Buck. I think, you know, this is huge, and when you talk about it and when you tell about it later, it's not just going to be the first black president was inaugurated in 2008. It's the first black president after years of, there's more to it, and there's more to the memory than just reciting the facts. When we partake of communion, when this do in remembrance of me, it is supposed to take us to something that we didn't actually get to see, but the impact of it we still feel. It is supposed to take our minds to the gore of it and the horror of it that was, if I ran a church and we were doing communion and we would do it with the backdrop of the Passion of the Christ on the screen. Because aside from just the elements, the visual takes you someplace else and makes you relive something that you never experienced. That's what this do in remembrance of me means. And that every time you eat this bread and drink of this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death. Now let me, this is a passage of scripture we read, and how am I doing? Okay, I gotta cut this. I'm not gonna go through all that. I do wanna deal with one other thing. Just to abbreviate this, once you remember what we read on New Year's Eve about those feasts. He told, in those feasts, he said, this is gonna be a brand on your hand and a brand on your forehead. And when you talk to your children and they ask you why you're doing this, you're going to tell them it's because the Lord brought us out with a strong hand. There's a parallel between what he's telling them, this view of remembrance of me, and the way God talked about the way that I want you to remember these, have experienced these feasts. And I don't have the time, maybe at some point in time, probably around Easter, maybe I'll get to come back and deal with the idea that Jesus, in having this feast at this time and phrasing this way, is paralleling himself to the Passover and to the Feast of Unleavened Bread, showing a new degree of deliverance purchased by a new covenant. There's a very strong parallel that exists there that I don't have the time to get into. What I do want to get into before we go is, what does it mean to take of, to receive it unworthily? We see in here that Paul talks about people who took it unworthily and they got sick and some of them are dead. What does that mean? What have you understood it to mean? Because I'm sure everybody's heard this warning. Make sure you don't take it unworthily or else you're going to get sick and die.
You got sin in your life. It's not good to take it.
You said you shouldn't take communion if you don't have the Holy Ghost.
You shouldn't take it if you don't have the Holy Ghost. That if you have sin in your life, you shouldn't take communion.
If you have an ought against your brother or something like that,
then
forgive.
Okay.
Yeah, that's one of them.
If you have an ought against your brother. All good answers. None of them can be justified by the context of this scripture, okay? When I say, what does it mean to take it unworthily? There's two different questions, that two different ways you could hear the question. One could be a question of, what do you think it means to take it unworthily? The other question is, what was Paul talking about when he said take it unworthily? Okay?
You're not recognizing why he died up on the cross for?
Right. What the backdrop, when we read this entire passage, 17 through 34, I know there was some shuffling and some things going on, but Paul was talking about a very specific problem here. Folks were coming in, and you see, we just had the crackers. They actually had loaves of unleavened bread that they would pass around. And so folks would come to take the Lord's Supper and sit there and eat all they could get, and the poor people would go hungry. Mm-hmm. Because for them, this was not a moment of reflection or anything. I'm here to, and some of, he said that some folks go hungry and other folks sit there and get drunk. Yeah. Lord's Supper, we're passing around wine.
That's right.
Let's just assume that it's some decent wine.
Yeah.
Because we don't want to dishonor God by having cheap wine in our. So I'm coming and I'm getting drunk. It's New Year's Eve. Somebody's going to a party. Somebody else is going to have communion and they're getting drunk. That's the specific issue that he's confronting them. You got people that are broke, people that are poor, people that don't have most of the time, and you're gathering together and you've got this collection of food that you can serve out. And rather than making sure that everybody's taken care of and everybody's getting their due portion, because this is about Christ and this is supposed to be reflecting the love of Christ and who he was and the character of Christ, you got folks just trying to eat because there's food there, and then these other people are starving. Taking it unworthily in the context of the passage was talking about taking it without having any kind of regard for what you're doing.
Right, okay.
Without having any kind of concern for the fact that the way that I conduct myself in this is supposed to reflect somebody that I'm supposed to be trying to commemorate. I would hope that if anybody ever had a commemorative feast for me, you would have Fred Hammond and Prince playing as part of the soundtrack.
Amen.
That you would not go and get some Chris Brown or some Fetty Wap and play it in something that's supposed to be commemorative. I hope y'all know me better than that. I hope you know that if I were to die and you would have that feast, I would come back after you.
We know you better than that.
Okay, so. Feast of. I don't know what she said, but I don't know what she said. Feast of commemoration to Christ, and you got the poor people, the people that were most important to Christ, being overlooked.
Yes.
The people that were most important to Christ that he went out of his way to minister to, still going hungry. There's a problem there.
Yeah.
And he said, that's why some of y'all are sick. Because you're dishonoring me by the way you're conducting this feast. So, should you, I'll speak to the Holy Ghost and sin in your life. But this passage and what he's talking about, it is talking about people who are engaging in this feast and have no regard whatsoever for what they're doing.
He came to the party, not for what the party was for, but for the stuff at the party.
Right.
The crash away.
Basically, you get drunk.
Yeah. For free. So, as to, and this is the last point I'm going to hit, and I'm going to try to move through it quickly because we're at about time. As to the Holy Ghost, as to sin in your life, I have, when you look at history, the Feast of Unleavened Bread that we mentioned before, was everybody who was in Israel had to follow those regulations. When the Feast of Unleavened Bread came around, and you couldn't eat leaven, you couldn't have it on our property. Didn't matter if you were native-born Israel, if you were a citizen there, anybody that was there had to follow that. On the other hand, the only people that could partake of the Passover feast were those who were circumcised and consecrated. So you see opportunities where every places where everybody has to, you see other places where other people were only the circumcised or the consecrated, those who were part of Israel, were able to take place. It's my belief, and I was my belief, that there is an inherent contradiction in the idea of a non-believer engaging in a practice that remembers the life and death of Christ and celebrates the new covenant. Now, take it within a biblical context. Nobody ever asked that question, because there's no way in the world anybody that was not a believer would ever want to take place in, like, the last thing you wanted to do was be a Christian anyway. There's no way somebody that didn't believe was ever going to try to partake in the supper with, over somebody that got strung up on a cross, and these you got these whack jobs over here running around talking about he came back up and they speaking. And, no, nobody's going to do that. So that's why the question never really came up, and you don't really see it being directly addressed with. But in terms of understanding the spirit of what you're supposed to do, how can someone have the capacity to commemorate that which they reject by abstaining from discipleship to the person who the is the focus of the communion? There's something that's a disconnect there. I can't say biblically, you shouldn't take communion without the Holy Ghost. Don't have verse or passage to back that necessarily. I can't even say that you shouldn't take it if you have sin in your life, because we all have periods where we mess up or make mistakes. But it would be great if you didn't, or you didn't have unrepentance, and it would be outstanding if everybody who decides to take communion decides that they're going to examine themselves and repent of anything that they know that they are engaged in that is unpleasing to God. As a matter of fact, you probably should do that. I just can't biblically say you can't take this. If you're not going through that process, it kind of causes there's some deeper issues there, we'll say, if you're not doing that. But there's something that just does not fit between somebody who does not believe trying to participate in a celebration or a commemoration of somebody that you don't believe in. It would be, okay, let's do this. It would be like having a celebratory feast for President Obama and Clinton. How does that work?
No, it's not like the chicken.
You want the chicken? And they bring a watermelon. Somehow the two just don't match up.
Total chaos.
It doesn't fit in my belief. And if I were to talk to an unbeliever, if we were ever to have communion, that's the kind of conversation we'd have. We're like, why are you looking to take communion if you don't believe?
Right.
There's something that just does not fit. So am I going to say the person can't, or that the church is wrong if they allow everybody in the congregation to just, if you're here, grab a cup? My belief is that does not really fit or make sense. But, like I said, that's not what this specific passage is addressing when it says those who take it unworthily. This passage is talking about one thing, but as the question of whether or not unbelievers should take communion, I have a real hard time making sense out of that. So, any questions or comments as we close this out? Next week, first time we met on a fourth Sunday in a very long time. At one time we were meeting the second and fourth Sundays. But, special fourth Sunday service, we're going to talk about anointing and what it means when you actually anoint something with oil, and doesn't really matter if I'm a teacher and I go through and anoint all my desks with oil. What does that do? What does that matter? Why does it matter? What am I doing? What's special about the anointing? About anointing oil, why does it matter? Why do you see people that carry little bottles around with it? If my husband's acting up, or my wife's acting up, and I put some anointing oil on the pillow where she sleeps, is that gonna make her act right?
Well,
I started off with my husband, but I don't. That I had to switch. Okay, if I'm acting up and my wife decides to put some anointing on the pillow where I sleep, or lying. Okay.
It's too late.
Too late.
What you want from me?